Thank you very much. So this place was very important for me, and also, of course, to meet at this place René Thom. Jean-Pierre calls this the berceau of somebody who studies mathematics, so I'm very happy to return back to my own berceau. And so, Tom.
This building was not.
No, no, but about the other side of the wall. But so, and the. Of course, the we heard many things how people appreciated the presence of René Thom, especially in his seminar. So I do not repeat those things, but give examples. So the small remarks he made during the talk or after the talk or at the tea time in the other building were extremely helpful for me. So one simple example was, what is a Chebyshev polynomial? So I forgot many times the formula. But René Thom gave the definition. It's polynomial seen as a mapping from C to C. It is a Morse mapping and has only two critical values. If you know this, you can, during lifetime, forget again the formula, which is my case. And then you can see those Chebyshev polynomials as a deformation of a singularity. The singularity in one variable, x to the power n, deforms to the Chebyshev polynomial, which is a morsification, the way people say it later, of the singularity with two critical values. After this, you can ask yourself, do there be other singularities in other dimensions, local isolated singularities of hypersurface singularities, like in the Milner book, such that they admit a morsification with only two critical values? Answer is yes, they exist, and this gives another characterization of what people call simple singularities. Simple in the categorical sense, those singularities are related to Lie groups, and they have famous names, AN, DN, E, 6, 7, 8. And this, the theorem is that are the only ones which have a morsification with two critical values. Then other saying of Thom was, if you see a singularity, then you must think you see a manifold which is collapsed. Concentrated manifold, or the various way of thinking this. And then, of course, you must decollapse it, make it visible again. And one way is to produce a deformation of the defining equation of the hypersurface singularity, such that the deformed function is easier to understand. Easier to understand means Morse with critical values. And that was, the Brieskorn school did this before. And then the problem in the Brieskorn school was, you have those critical values, they sit in the disk. So you have the disk of critical values, you have a few critical values. Then if you wish to do monodromy, you must take a base point and connect all those to the base point. And this is, of course, possible, but there are many ways of doing this. So what you do after a whole work day of work, it has no canonical meaning. It is just more up to what you draw here than what you get. So it computes the monodromy as a product of simpler things, as in the case of plane curves, Dehn twists, and in the case of higher dimension, a kind of Dehn twist, on which we will come back later. And so Thom said, if we start from a real equation, we should have a deformation such that the critical values lie on the real line. Then you take, so this is a picture in C. The disk in C, you take a critical value, a regular value, say in the lower half plane, then to connect everybody is no own choice, it's a canonical. And then you get a monodomain presentation which is less affected by choices on the way. Yeah? So you have such a thing. So concretely, and that's still today an open question, you have a complex hypersurface singularity given by a real equation. Can you find a deformation, a real deformation, which has the property that all the morph, which is a morphification, pardon, which is a morphification, such that all the things which are important, the critical points, the critical values, everything is real. So Sabir Cousin-Zadek could do this for plane curve singularities by some method. I could do this the same thing also for plane curve singularities by some other method. But for three variables, it is completely open. To find a deformation which is a morphification, starting from a real representative for your equations and keeping everything real. And that would lead to an effective algorithmic way to compute, say, the integral monodomy matrix of a complex hypersurface singularity in three variables. The integral homology matrix. So compute the eigenvalues is done by Gauss-Manin and is a very good computer program, singular, and the computer program is in fact is also a program can done by humans who have say months of time, not a few seconds, but that is the only difference. It is still a real program. But to do this, to get the integral matrix, is I think completely open. So for three variables, integral monodomy is complicated. So there are, of course, many ways to compute monodomy. And Tom's idea was you have this Milner fiber, and inside the Milner fiber, you must first find something of lower dimension, a retract. So the way you see it is you retract the boundary of the Milner fiber to something of half real dimension of the Milner fiber. A retraction. And this thing in the middle should have internal structure such that combinatorially you see already the monodomy. So there is one example, is the FAM construction of the FAM spine of the Milner fiber. So, but this FAM construction works not for all singularities, for singularities given by a very typical equation. So the typical equation, so I wish to do it in many variables, and for me many means three. Très. Three. So this is the defining equation. And A, B, C are integers, all I, we are bigger than two. So what is the FAM spine? You must solve the equation this equal to one.
Write your name.
Huh?
Write your name.
Ah, FAM, Friedrich FAM. So we do the FAM construction. We wish to solve this equation. So first we look at solutions which written in coordinates look like this. So then T should, at this place, you have the set of A roots of unity. And then if we look at solutions of this type, then here we can put a B root of unity, the same here. So we have already a few points on the level set equal to one. So what this means is is, we can now make many. So this one we can split as alpha plus beta plus gamma, and all three are positive real numbers. So instead of solving xA to the equal to 1, I solve equal to alpha. So then here I have A roots of unity of alpha times mu alpha of choices. And the same happens here and in the third one also. So the set, the splittings of A plus B plus gamma equal to 1, keeping positive, is the definition of a simplex. So in doing this, we find in this set a simplex. Delta I J K. I is an A root of unity, J is a B root of unity, and K is C root of unity. So we have all those simplices. And then, of course, when I vary the value of this, we have many simplices. So altogether, we have the number of simplices. The number of those simplices is A times B times C. And they are glued together, and that is the thumb spine. But I wish to see the monodromy from this thing. And not only the homological monodromy, I wish to see the geometric monodromy. I wish to see a diffeomorphism being the monodromy. And I wish also to see this, that it preserves some structure. And preserves some structure, it should be symplectic. So that is the goal. So, what? There appears another one? So, what we...
It's still another, yes.
Still three. Okay. So what we do is we make those simplices. We need to have an internal structure in this simplex. And the aim is, so we have this thumb spine, sigma, and the monodromy of this equation, and no need to define, Bernard did this yesterday. So the monodromy of this equation, the aim, what I wish to explain is, the monodromy T of this equation, B plus Z to the power C, the monodromy is a Dehn twist with with sole sigma. So I must say, what is a Dehn twist with sole sigma? We know what is a Dehn twist if we are on a surface, a Dehn twist around the curve, we know, but I wish to have to explain you later what is a Dehn twist with sole sigma. And monodromy is such a Dehn twist. So in order to do this, we need to put a structure on those simplices. And the structure I put on the simplices, and that's also the reason why I like to be three variables, I think each simplex as a spherical simplex on the sphere of radius 1 in R3 with right angles. So each simplex is now a spherical simplex. So it sits in the two-sphere. And this is the two-sphere which sits in R3. The two-sphere of radius 1 in R3. And it comes a simplex. So, if we have a point in such a simplex, everybody knows what it means to walk in with long a geodesic from some point on. And we walk in with the spherical metric. We walk this way. So there are many simplices. And so on each corner, there is a root of unity. So this is the first variable. Here we think we we in the first triple and then and so on. Hmm? So, and let's imagine that I start walking and hit the boundary of the simplex. So I wish to continue walking. What I do is I take next root of unity of the one I see here. So in the roots of unity, there's a cyclic ordering. I take next and do nothing with the others. So there is, will be a new simplex here. Of course, it is difficult to draw right angles for the new one.
Can you explain a bit more? Here and there, I cannot follow.
Ah, okay, okay, okay. I forgot this. Yeah, okay, okay. So we on this spherical simplex, from a given point on, we start walking along geodesic rays. Geodesic in terms of the spherical metric. And then we can hit the boundary of a simplex, the vertex of that simplex, or the different roots of unity in the, on the various coordinate, complex coordinate axes of ambient space. So when we hit the boundary of the simplex, there are generically two roots of unity, which are the endpoints of that boundary interval. Hmm? And there is one root of unity, which is on the back, which is not used. So what I do is, I modify the non-used root of unity. Here it was k. I imagine what here was v. Ah, no, the picture is wrong. We I imagine we hit the boundary segment where the roots of unity are a and k. So j is not involved. So I make a new simplex by taking instead of j next root of unity j plus plus next and take the simplex I k j plus plus. So this is a turning around the boundary interval of one simplex about some angle. Hmm? So this turning, I wish to find back the forgotten dimensions. So the thumb spine is of half a real dimension, and I wish to find back the forgotten dimensions. So I think this the simplex IJK as sitting in the cotangent bundle of the two sphere. So this thickens, this restores the forgotten dimensions. And what I do is I take the epsilon neighborhood of this of the simplex in the cotangent bundle. So if we had lower dimension, it would become what people call the stadium. The simplex becomes an interval, then we make the interval larger, and at the endpoints we put disks. Hmm? That is the way the epsilon neighborhood of such a simplex. And then the next one, where we modified the corner j to j plus 1, is turn this. But this rotation is the Hamiltonian action of the distance to the geodesic boundary ik of that simplex. So the thickenings glue together by an explicit symplectic map. So that means the whole story has a symplectic structure. And the simplices on which we talked, they are all Lagrangian submanifolds.
So you get cyclic ordering in codimension one, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then of course, when this walk from the point goes to a corner, then we go to say the K corner, then the I and J vertices, which are roots of unity on the other axis, both of them I make them to the next. So then the new simplex is, we have I plus plus plus, J plus plus plus, and the K remains. So those simplices only meet at one corner. Then the statement, what is metrically special for this spine is, if we do this walking, if we hit the boundary, we continue on next page, which is this turning business of the simplicius, and we walk, if we walk a distance by, and we do this from a given point in every possible direction, then the statement is all those intervals end at a same point, a kind of cut locus point, on the spine. So the spine, a sphere has this property. If we do A, B, and C equal to 2, the thumb spine makes a sphere. And on the sphere, you have the property, if from a given point you walk geodesically length pi, you are at the opposite point. Here you are at some point, which I do not call opposite, because what you can figure out, if from that new point you walk again, you don't go back. So it is not an involution. So you find new points. This is enough to define a Dehn twist. What you do is I draw it in one dimension less again, so we have the cylinder, and here we have those on the circle on the cylinder we cut in four intervals, so I think the equation, the singularity x squared plus y squared, I forget the z for. Then what the walk business, you go to the opposite point. So, what is a Dehn twist? Radiate lines which go to the core circle of the Dehn twist, you twist them, keeping them fixed far away from the circle, and drag the foot point of such a line along the circle above a walking path to the common point. So this defines a Dehn twist of the thickening of the thumb spine. So if we walk, come and go to a point of the spine, we walk on the spine, but we keep the endpoint fixed, and we walk, and when we go to infinity, we walk on less and less, and say if we are at some distance away from the spine, we don't walk at all. So we have a Dehn twist localized near the spine. So now one can perhaps think every singularity has such a spine.
How do you know that it is really a spine?
By construction. Yeah. And I simplified many things Pham did not talk about. So, can be optimistic and think every singularity has such a spine. So, this is optimistic. Then you are less optimistic. Every singularity in two variables has such a spine. Also too optimistic, but not completely wrong. Not completely wrong. So the true statement in dimension 2, and that is own work, and then corrected by Pablo Portilla Cuadrado. The names are in my abstract, the precise spellings and so on. There is a version of this for ribbon surfaces. So if you have a graph, you can make out of this graph a ribbon surface on the blackboard. But perhaps the blackboard is not the good behind. Perhaps you have to thicken by ribbons which are twisted a few times. So then you get a ribbon surface, and imagine that this graph has what I call tete-a-tete property. On a graph, at a point, you can walk away in two directions. So in this example, we can walk away in a circle of directions. Here only two. But what we assume is that when we walk away in both directions over some distance, so the graph is not only a graph, it is a metric graph. Every edge has a length. And we walk away over a fixed distance, again say pi, we should be at the same point.
It doesn't make sense because you go to a ramification point, you should choose it.
It is a ribbon surface.
Yes.
So at the ramification point, there is a cyclic order here. So you do the same. You go on next page according to that cyclic order. So we copy what we learned in dimension 3 back to dimension 2.
So it means that all boundaries have the same length. Yeah.
No. The length could be different. The
boundary components of the surface, of Wilkinson's surface is boundary.
Yeah.
Then all boundary components have the same length.
Yeah. Yes. Boundary components. Yeah. So then could think the monotomy for singularities in two variables is such a business, Dehn twist along with curves, a graph, and the graph has this property which let's say call a tete-a-tete property. So that is true in the following sense. The Milner fiber of a plane curve singularity can be cut in pieces. And on each piece, this story is true. And the gluing is such that the corrections, the speed corrections, where we glue boundaries of those pieces together, should all be positive. This statement is perfectly parallel and equivalent to the statement Bernard told about Puiseux inequalities yesterday. So this is a geometric way of seeing the Puiseux inequalities. So in dimension 2, something of this story remains true. That's what I say. Now you go to higher dimensions. Higher dimensions. So higher dimensions, this thumb spine was constructed from a very special equation. So I used explicitly this equation. So question is, can we find the thumb spine not using this special equation? So when we have a singularity, Cn plus 1 to C, local singularity at zero, value of f at zero is zero, exactly like Bernard yesterday. Then we have an isolated singularity, that means the differential of f is zero at zero and non-zero in the neighborhood of zero. So what we can do is we can take the L2 norm of the differential. That is a real function on Cn plus 1, which is zero at zero, and near zero is non-zero. And we use this instead of the Euclidean metric. We use this to say what is a ball. A ball around zero means a level, a sphere around zero means a level set for small values of this function. And this is real analytic. Curve selection lemma works. You can copy Milner's book. Everything works. So you have a fibration, you have a Milner fibration, everything, where you use this as definition of the what people call the Milner ball. And then you can take the gradient of this, which the gradient of, so I make the picture, the gradient of this function contracts the singular fiber to zero. And if I take a nearby fiber and I look what happens away from, on a look at what happens in a sphere in the new setting, away from the singular point, there on the nearby fibers, I see the beginning of a contraction. But of course, the origin is missing. It contracts to something which we do not know yet. It contracts to something. So the flow lines of the gradient of this contract the boundary of the Milner fiber to something. Statement, if we do this for the polynomial, for a Van Brieskorn polynomial, then we find back the thumb spine. It retracts exactly to the thumb spine. So this definition of thumb spine uses less the special form of this. So we can try to think, be optimistic again. We say this works in all dimensions forever. This is again wrong. But still not completely wrong. Still not, it is possible to, here it is, three you say. So we, instead of talking about many variables, we go back to two variables. In two variables, we knew already something along this line works, but works for the Milner monodromy. Now we can be more optimistic and say we want it should work for the monodromy group. So we unfold, we do déploiement, which is in the title of the talk. We do déploiement and we wish to have the monodromy representation, which is the fundamental group of the complement of the discriminant. And we wish to see this monodromy representation along those lines. Again, that it really works till the very end, it is too optimistic. We must now take less singularities. But in doing this, we learn something which allows me to make a kind of conjecture for all other Plinkov singularities. So the singularities on which you talk are they call the AN singularity. So this is an AN singularity. So here we have differential of the equation. And we can take the norm. I will take square of the norm. And still does not work. But here we have a preferred variable. So we can take the partial derivative. The partial derivative. And when I do this on a fiber, the fiber equal to one, this one disappears. And y square derivative is y. So the partial derivative is roughly the same as what I see there, is x to the power n plus one. I forgot to perhaps,
Over two?
Yeah, over two, but this
no,
I
n plus one over
Yeah, but I do not, this detail I do not like at the moment. I agree with you, I do not like. I could prepare the equation a little here, to have no constants to bother about.
No, it's not constants, it's exponent.
Ah, exponent.
N plus 1 over 2, yeah.
Ah.
Okay.
Ah, yeah, thank you. That two was missing, yeah. I was thinking, okay, that is important too. Okay, so this idea also works when I perturb here and unfold the singularity. See, here we do the unfolding parameters. Ah, déploiement. So yesterday I heard that in this room, some years ago, in the room there, people spoke French, huh? This, yeah. So, to remember this, I write déploiement. Okay. So, now, we take gradients of, and here, the norm, of course, I forgot norm. So, the norm of this part is very, very interesting. So we have monic polynomials. There is no coefficient there's one coefficient missing here. If you do the déploiement. Some.
X n minus one.
X to the power of minus 1. 5 minus, oh, okay. Ah, merci. So, the dynamics which we wish to do with this, but we do it in fact with this, is the dynamics of the polynomial given by this expression. And what we do, we have to do absolute value, and we have the dynamics of the gradient of such a thing. And there we know already a lot. So perhaps the thing which is when we, this is now C, huh? C, and here is infinity. So, and the polynomial has roots. And we start at infinity by a gradient line. Then the gradient lines at infinity are parameterized by a little circle. So the amount of gradient lines starting at infinity has a probability measure. And now we can ask when such a gradient line starts, which probability we had the root. If your gradient lines go to the zero of the derivative of the polynomial, this is measure zero, so the full measure goes to some root. And then the thing which surprised me is all roots are of equal probability. So if I take the polynomial x to the power 1001 minus x, the roots of this is zero, and the 1000 unity roots of unity on the circle. So now I come from infinity. So normally I was thinking this line is kept by one of the roots, so almost dense sets of roots on the unit circle, and you come from infinity and you go to one of them. And it's very difficult to hit the root in the middle. No, it's not true. For every polynomial, if you start at infinity, the roots you get is exactly the multiplicity of that root. So when all roots of multiplicity 1, you get them with the same probability. So this, and then you can say a little more. So you have the roots of the derivative, and you have the roots, you have the roots of the polynomial. And typically what you see is a graph, which is a tree. Some go to the middle of the edge of a tree, where is the root of the derivative of the polynomial. You have such a tree. So it retracts to a tree. But this tree can be upgraded to a geometric Dinkin diagram of the singularity. So what I should say, this circle at infinity had a base point that is the real direction, which I could say 1. So the picture is you have this tree and then a line coming from infinity, which goes, say, to one root. And out of this, you can make a representation of vanishing cycles of the hypersurface singularity, which is written here. And they built the usual chain of vanishing cycles, an AN chain. But if you change the coefficients, this graph changes, and the picture of your vanishing cycle changes also. So statement is, if you say two polynomials are in the same chamber, if the picture, the gradient picture is the same, then you get cells. That's the statement. The number of cells is a Catalan number. The walls are easy to describe. And the change of the Dinkin diagram is, there are two types of walls. The change of Dinkin diagram is also easy to describe. And that is the special thing here. There's one topic which I how many is left?
Two
minutes. Oh, that's a lot. Ah, so I was afraid less. So there is, by real mortification for two variable polynomials, one can find generators of the monodynamic group on the mapping class level. That can be done. Then, very recently, Pablo Portilia Quadrado, and then easy name, Nick Salters. They give a description of the monomer group for a plane curve singularity from the outside. They say an element in the mapping class group is realizable in the unfolding of a given singularity if and only if something happens. And if and only if the Milner fiber of a plane curve singularity has an extra structure which is a framing, a canonical framing. So if you have two variables, dx wedge dy is a complex symplectic form. Then the levels of a plane curve singularity are given by a holomorphic function. So you can take the symplectic gradient with respect to this symplectic form on each level. So this gives a non-zero vector field on the regular fibers of the unfolding. And then, if you take such a regular fiber and you think that this is the base point regular fiber, then you can say the monomies you can realize by going around the discriminant are exactly those mapping class groups which preserve the framing coming from this vector field. That's the new theorem. That is a theorem of the two names I said. So this theorem makes out of those data a framing and forgot the vector field. The vector field is slightly more as a framing because you have a first vector. Framing is a trivialization of the tangent bundle. And if you know one vector, then the other vector comes from the complex structure. But the if you take the vector field, the symplectic gradient of F, then this gives you a foliation on the Milner fiber. And now you can start making chambering again. You say two fibers in the unfolding are in the same chamber, if and only if the foliations are isotopic. And this gives perhaps, and it's a perhaps is a question, this gives perhaps a monodomy description for the monodomy group of plane curve singularities by stratification, chambering, and wall crossing. So, thank you very much.
Question?
Maybe just remark, I think it's younger generations also follow the Huckey-Zeiger categories and skeletons and people.
Yeah. So, Yasha's school, imagine all possible spines. Yeah. And then they say, what are the possible ways of putting symplectic thickening around? Yeah. And so, here it is the arboreal singularity. Here it is the other way. I start from the singularity and do not wish to know all possibilities, only those which are perhaps of interest for the singularity. That's the other strategy.
Mm-hmm. Any question?
So this example of IN singularity is an example where the Stahlbeck is a smooth curve.
Which is
The Stahlbeck, because we have Stahlbeck.
Stahlbeck.
It's a smooth.
Smooth.
And in fact, for instance, for the Moisher exponent is easy to calculate in this case. Yeah. And so the question which was put in Zadar, I think, was addressing whether for fixed degree the maximum of the Moisher exponent is obtained on AN singularity.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if it probably has nothing to do with your but. Because you make a perturbation of this, yes?
I perturb this term under the Jacobian ideal. So therefore, next term disappears, and then here I put anything. So it are monic polynomials such that the sum of the roots is zero. balanced monic polynomials. And we work in this, and this set gets stratified. There are also other stratifications related to breed group action and so on, but this is a stratification which is related to the monodomy group of the singularity. In both appear Catalan numbers, but this, the cells are different. What? What are the consequences?
Yeah, what are some applications?
Application. I can have a very bad answer. One application was, I was invited here. But it's not the answer you like. Eh? But there must be application, but I did not think about this. So I was obsessed during many years in computing monodomy. And that fact on its own was already motivation. But monodomy perhaps appears at other places. Perhaps.
In the picture that you described before, you don't go back to the same point.
Yeah. The thumb spine. Yeah, the application is, it leads immediately to questions. So when I perturb, what is the set of perturbations of all those metrics and these gluings keeping the tete-a-tete property, that paths of given lengths go to the same point? I do not know if this is rigid data or if it is flexible. I think it is flexible. It is computing the dimension. The space of deformations is the dimension of the mu constant stratum near that singularity. So, but this I do not know yet.
Okay, we stop here and start again.